So as per the introduction, what I want to chat to you about is the expectation gap. And we've had some very interesting experiences as a business. For those of you that know BrandsEye, you might know a couple of the stories that I'm going to share with you today. But what I want to show you is a little bit of what sits beneath the hood of what we do. So rather than actually give you a bit of a sales pitch, we want to give you a little piece of the methodology. And I think to speak to some of the points that that Mark was making, what is interesting is that the future is emerging in the conversations that you're able to track and interpret and apply to the way businesses, in fact, a number of your businesses and certainly the clients that you might work with, in the context of this incredible information-driven universe that we live in. So this might seem like a fairly obvious statement, but this is something that has guided the development of our business, and I think in terms of the theme of today's talk, our digital journey. And that we believe that the way people express their feelings today influences the way they act tomorrow. And what I want to talk about is some of the dimensions around those feelings and why they're important. Because whether you take the point that Mark is making, that we are linear creatures, the one very interesting component that makes us unique as living beings is how we apply emotion to either making sense of that linear process, how we resolve complexity, and how we simplify that into a space where we can actually make decisions. So as you well know, and this is a very educated audience, so you know all about what social media is about, what it's done in terms of the spread of information, and what's been interesting for us is why we no longer consider what we do as social listening, just to qualify what Tim mentioned earlier. We refer to ourselves as an opinion mining business. And we believe that it is in the information of understanding the way human beings interact with each other that intelligence exists that can actually guide the way businesses should be making decisions about their respective futures. So what makes a lot of what we do possible, I mean, to give you a sense of how big BrandsEye is, we now have about 60 employees, that's people on the payroll, split between our Cape Town head office. We have an office in Joburg. We've got an office in Dubai, and we're opening up an office in London as well. But out of those 60 people, we are processing millions upon millions of conversations. And obviously what makes that possible, which I'm sure you're all familiar with, is artificial intelligence and machine learning. But what we have found is that the application of natural language processing only allows us to reach a certain level of accuracy. And this level of accuracy, just so you're aware, the most powerful natural language processes that sit behind how algorithm-driven solutions make sense of human conversation are only able to deliver an accuracy rate at best at 66, just over 66%. Now, just consider that for a second. 66%. 50% is a flip of the coin. So how can you be making strategic decisions in relation to a 66% probability that what your machines are telling you is correct? And if you want to know why robots end up ending in pools, it's because they can only make certain, at this particular point of their computing capability, they cannot resolve the complexity of their circumstances. They certainly cannot resolve the complexity in the way human beings communicate with each other. And this irritated a lot of the engineers that are the founders of this business. Now, what we did seemed to be almost counterintuitive, and we tested this by chucking a number of interns at it to begin with, and over time developed a platform where what we do is we take statistically significant portions of the conversations that we're looking on behalf of our clients, and we give them to people. Why do we do that? Well, if you think about language, language is not literal, it is symbolic. The way we communicate with each other, the actual meaning sits between the lines, not on the lines. So machines can get cleverer, but can they interpret mixed languages? Just think about us as South Africans, the amount of languages we might use in one sentence and the way that we interact with each other. I mean, you know, yeah, wat sê jy? It's just something that is part not only of our lives, but any person who uses language. In addition to that, the sentiment that is actually communicated is not found in the words, it's found in the context. And what we do is we've hired thousands of people all over the world with different language capabilities and different contextual capabilities in order to improve that accuracy. And by doing this, we've been able to prove that we can deliver an accuracy rate of over 90%. Now, why is that important? Well, I hope that speaks for itself. If you had a piece of information and you could turn around to a client and say, what we're about to deliver to you, there's a confidence level in this of 95% and a margin of error of 3% as a standard outcome, I think that speaks a lot more than 66%. Without getting into the sales pitch, what I want to share with you is how we then apply that methodology. And I think it's an important thing to appreciate is that effectively what we are doing, we are no longer social listening. We are a research and intelligence business. We are able to take conversation en masse and be able to deliver outcomes that completely confound the traditional research methodologies that you're normally faced with. If you think about the sampling rates that are involved in the type of guides that we end up having to live our lives by, that our clients' lives are lived by, in terms of net promoter score, in terms of reputation surveys, in terms of all kinds of other qualitative research methods, because of the cost of how you actually gather that information, the outcome is by its nature flawed. And what social media allows you to do is increase that sample size, and by applying machines and human beings, you can deliver that accuracy rate. Is everybody comfortable with that in terms of the science that sits behind this? So when we look at opinion data, we don't think it's a problem. What we think is that it delivers a solution, not only for human understanding, but to understand humans and the way they actually behave, the way they think and the way they feel. So these are a couple of case studies that I want to share with you. And to give you a bit of the back office insight in terms of how we had the results that we received out of this. Everybody knows what the media was saying, what the pundits were saying, politicians, the press, other social listening tools, etc. They were all pointing to a Remain result. And I remember a conversation very, very specifically. It was about a week before this result was coming out, and I was sitting down with our CEO JP, and he showed me data that pointed to this: is that suddenly there was a completely contrarian perspective on what the likelihood of a result was going to be. People were saying different things to what the pundits were talking about, and the business faced a very critical and the most perfect catch-22 situation. At that particular time, we had a deal with CNBC Africa where every single week we were producing pieces of research to then, you know, communicate on CNBC Africa about some topical issue. And the topical issue of that week was Brexit. And BrandsEye started looking at the Brexit data 1 week before it needed to be communicated. And we start looking at this data, and we're realizing, hang on a second, how on earth do we communicate this? And what ended up happening is JP was on this on CNBC Africa and was asked for his opinion. I mean, and you can imagine the kind of, the tension between, do we actually say what we see, or do we actually give an opinion? And I think it's very important to note that when we talk about what happened with Brexit and what I'm going to show you about the US elections, is that we didn't predict the outcome of these elections. All we did was communicate and commentate on what people were saying about those outcomes. And what proved to be the actual truth inside it is not the fact that we were able to look at that conversation in aggregate, but because of the type of source of the data that we get, which is available to all of us in terms of, you know, what happens on social media, we're able to get geolocation data, which allowed us to start looking at that result on a city and a town basis. And as it turned out, it wasn't absolutely accurate, but it was certainly more accurate than any other commentator on this particular issue in the world. A small little company from Cape Town listening to social media, doing a few interesting calculations about how they modeled the data, and particularly looking at what sat behind it, came up with that result. So we got a little bit more ambitious, and we started to look at the US elections.
Sorry, what did you say on CNBC?
That leave was going to happen. Yeah, so, yes, sorry. Yes. So the US elections. Now, obviously, this is a completely different ante, but completely different beast. And what did everybody else say? I think we can all remember that everybody was expecting a Clinton landslide. In fact, I think The Guardian was talking about being a complete renaissance of the liberalization, you know, the liberation of the world and its and liberal values. Well, we all know what happened since then. Now, what was interesting about this circumstance is we started tracking the data months before, and although we didn't want the outcome to happen in terms of the future of the world, what things pointed to was a similar result as to what happened on Brexit. And we faced a very interesting situation, a bit of a conundrum about saying, well, here we've managed to get Brexit right and we have the evidence to say that we did predict the outcome of Brexit, or call the outcome of Brexit, let me qualify. We are seeing a different result emerging in terms of Trump. And I remember the conversation with JP. We were standing in a meeting and he said, Cole, what do you think about me heading to London and making myself available in case we get the call? I said, well, what have you got to lose, you know? If you're going on and they ask you a question and you say it's going to be the result that we think it's going to be, and you get it wrong, well, all you need to do is hedge it in terms of the commentary on that. But if you get it right, well, I mean, you know what happened next.
Well, with us now is Jean-Pierre Kloppers, CEO of BrandsEye. Now, BrandsEye is a media analysis firm which has been examining online commentary for and against the key candidates. Thanks for joining us. Just tell me a little bit more about what you've been doing exactly.
Great. So we listened to all the conversations emanating from the USA on social media. So it's 27 million conversations we've looked at over the past couple of weeks. And then we use BrandsEye's crowdsourcing kind of platform to try and decipher how do people feel in those conversations. It's 3 million people. So we look at a statistically significant sample of that data to try and work out in each state, what's the advocacy, what's the kind of emotion on the ground towards each of the candidates leading up to the elections, and how does that change as various events play out in reality?
So in a word, at the moment, you think Trump will win on your analysis?
Yeah, if you ask for my opinion, it's different, but if you ask for what we're seeing in the data, that is what the data is saying. It's saying he's got a huge amount of support, and I think we may have underestimated it.
Jean-Pierre Kloppers, really interesting to talk to you. Thanks
Great.
So much.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, that was 2 days before the outcome of the election. And you can imagine how many phone calls we suddenly got after the election in terms of hedge funds, asset managers. I mean, you name it. Everybody thought that this was like the answer to the world's problems. And the truth is that it's not. But in terms of being able to provide an opinion on it, be able to get to the bottom of it, that's kind of what this allows. Just to show you some of the stats of what's happening in the graph is to give you a sense of how sentiment shifts. It's not something that is static. And within the context of that shift, suddenly, in a very short space of time, what looked like a likely outcome changes. And this is a very interesting thing to take into account when it comes to dealing with human beings. We sit and we develop campaigns hoping that we're going to be hitting some linear outcome. People can change their minds and respond in very different ways with immediacy. And I think we've seen enough of those value-destructing, brand-destructing campaigns that can take place from very small oversights, like, for example, what happened with OutSurance and obviously a number of other issues as well. In this particular case, we looked at a very specific target, which was the battleground states, and we started to notice a trend that was pointing to what was a contrarian outcome compared to what the pundits were looking at. Once again, looking at the geographic data, that's where this truth started to become something that we were prepared to say something about. Now, since then, we've looked at things more than just politicians and elections. We still do that. But it's a lot easier to predict the outcome of a situation or at least call or commentate on a particular outcome when there's a binary outcome, where it's leave or remain, whether it's Clinton or Trump, as opposed to multiple candidates, multiple outcomes, so the complexity increases. Some of the other work that we've done, and to share this with you, is we looked at how CEOs, global CEOs, are ranked by looking at Twitter data over a particular year. And you can see from the names that are mentioned and the companies that they come from that there are some possible one or two surprises, but a lot of those you would expect them to be in the place that they are. Now, what's interesting about the drivers of positive sentiment, and this is something to reflect on as leaders and as actually advising leaders in other organizations. Company performance is certainly a key criteria that drives the sentiment. And I think an important thing about looking at sentiment is not just being able to understand how the person feels. I mean, if I was to use an analogy, it's probably helpful for me to know if my wife is upset with me about something, right? That will be helpful information. But what's far more useful is to understand why she's upset with me so I can actually do something about it. And if I don't do something about it, what is the likely outcome of that situation going to be? If I don't want to get divorced, then I'm probably going to be heading in that direction unless I change my behavior. And I think as obvious as that might sound, we sometimes forget that the way people express their feelings gives you an opportunity to intervene. It gives you an opportunity to actually correct and mend and invest back into that relationship. Or they will leave, or worse, which is what we're starting to notice in the work that we're doing, other competitors are starting to intervene and are starting to take customers because they are expressing themselves publicly in public domains. Okay? They are effectively dating those people while they are still with you. One of the other issues surrounding company performance and just talking about sentiment is that, yes, people respond positively to company performance when it comes to referring to CEOs. Two things which we found more interesting, they may sound obvious, but how many CEOs and leaders inside organizations that you're advising actually happen to do this? One is accessibility. And I think it's not just the fact that they have a Twitter account. It's the fact that they have a Twitter account and they are authentic in their interaction, that it is actually their Twitter account and they are the people who are operating it, or at least the voice behind it is something that appears to be authentic. And then finally, social and political leadership. And I think over the last year, if there's something that we certainly noticed when it comes to the corporate leaders, those leaders that are being celebrated are the leaders that are actually taking a stand and starting to communicate and actually take action in response to certain social and political needs. Whether it's towards Syrian refugees, whether it's towards gender issues, whether it's towards what's happening around LGBTQ and the awareness around that. These are what leaders are being judged by the public. Okay, this is something which I'm sure you were familiar with and exposed to, what happened with the United Airlines PR disaster. Everybody knows what happened in terms of the way that their CEO responded, that it was inauthentic, that they hid behind their PR policy. The public reaction was terrible. And what was interesting about this particular case is that just before this outcome, he was voted as the best communicator out of all global CEOs. And certainly that opinion did not end up carrying forward. Something more recent, and you may have seen this in the press in the last couple of days, is how sentiment data can also be used to really get to the bottom of key dynamics and material objectives within businesses. So one piece of work that we've been involved in over a number of years is tracking what is going on in the South African retail banking sector. And through social data, what we have done, coming back to what I mentioned earlier about understanding why people feel what they do, we have split that sentiment and identified which components of that conversation fit into what they consider to be the important outcomes with their customer experience, which ultimately has a major impact on their sales and earnings. So brand comparison, customer service, intent to cancel, lack of availability, pricing, staff, and turnaround time. As you probably well know, if you look at social media, clients are not going to talk about brand comparisons and intent to cancel. They just say, I hate this bank, I want to leave. Okay. but there is a level of a value that needs to be added in terms of verifying and categorizing that information in order to deliver the type of outcomes where Capitec, by looking at the data of what is happening between them and their competitors, can not only understand, or any of these banks in fact, can actually look at where they are succeeding. So everybody knows that Capitec does well around pricing, but that's not all. All the other banks are pretty bad at most things, as you can see. The difference is that Capitec is better than the rest at the good things. How does that translate over time? Okay, so in terms of net sentiment, the difference between the positive and the negative on aggregate, the darker Manhattan, just in case you can't see the stats over here, this is 2017, 2016, and 2015. What you can see is that Capitec is most definitely on the rise. ABSA is unfortunately plumbing the depths. Standard Bank's improving a little bit. FNB's recovering, and Nedbank's kind of middling out there. But in terms of share of voice, what is happening from this very small bank, what used to be a very small bank, is that slowly but surely there's actually a lot more people that are talking about who they are and what they're doing. What's most important is not just the metrics, you know, the number of people, the engagement, all the types of things that would normally come with ORM. It's about understanding what is the context of the session, what is the content of the conversation, and how does that actually give us intelligence and real-time data that can allow us to guide our clients in terms of strategic, operational, and tactical decision-making. We did some back testing on this to be able to look at it not only from a social media metrics perspective, but what has happened in terms of their market share over time. And what we have been able to see both in this and a number of other industries is how sentiment correlates to market share. The happier customers are, they either stay or they are acquired, as opposed to being lost. And in some cases, there's a lot of predatory activity happening between these banks when it comes to gaining their customers. Okay, Uber. This is always an interesting one. one of the pieces of work that we did was trying to understand what are the key topics that drive the sentiment of their clientele. And I think what this highlights, and something that is important, I mentioned this earlier, is that sentiment does shift over time. So it's none of these things where you should be expecting consistency. But I think what is the type of thing that we start to look at is what is the net impact of what happens when it comes to certain campaigns or activities that are happening inside a business. So that is not only marketing and communication. A lot of reputational issues actually come with all kinds of things. Could be pricing, etc. Now, these waves over here, you might not be able to see it, but you've got the green line is Chicago, the red line is Los Angeles, the blue line is New York, the gray line is San Francisco, and the peach line is Cape Town. And you can see how that net sentiment shifts. But you can compare different cities, not just looking at a business and how it compares to its competitors. And what we found particularly interesting by looking at it from a topics perspective is how you may have the same topics in the conversation, but the way that the conversation is actually deconstructed looks completely different. So in New York, there's a lot more talk about drivers. Okay, in Cape Town, there's a lot more about the ride experience and the purchase decision, as opposed to what people are talking about in New York. And what has been interesting in terms of being able to guide this and other clients is what are the topics that are driving that particular sentiment. So they know where to apply this across their business. It's no longer just for campaigning. So I see I have still quite a lot of time available, and I'm very happy to take questions and spend some time talking about this in detail. But what I wanted to leave you with is I think what should be quite an encouraging statement that I think links to what Mark was talking about earlier, is that when you think about the world and the way people are responding to politicians at the moment, and the fact that across the world there's just a democratization of government, What is very interesting is that within our environment, whether it's in South Africa, wherever there are human beings and wherever they can express an opinion, they are starting to shift the dial towards what they believe is actually going to work for them. So for example, in the US, that turned out to be Trump. In terms of the UK, they believed that Brexit was going to take them in that wrong direction. But what sits behind that is a significant amount of deception. And what we need to be aware of, and I think be the actual interpreters and the guides in that process as we are managing relationships with organizations, whether those organizations are governments, whether they're cities, whether they are corporates, whether they are brands, is that the world and how people are motivated and what they are saying can be manipulated. And it's about being able to understand where does that authenticity lie. And I think there's a massive opportunity for leaders in the business world, in the worlds that we work in, to really start being the voices, the authentic voices that can guide people, that can take people through this journey of uncertainty and actually give them some type of insight, some authentic insight into the steps that they need to take to make sense of this complexity we all struggle with on a daily basis. So, yeah, that's what I wanted to share with you today. And